You are listening to the Fringe Radio Network. FringeRadioNetwork.com.
Listening to Earth Oddity, a weekly odyssey into all the oddity planet Earth has to offer. And now, serving it up are Christopher Tiny Sullivan and John Wong.
Welcome, everybody, to another episode of Earth Oddity Podcast, your favorite podcast, my favorite podcast.
And my favorite podcast.
Tiny's favorite podcast. World's awesomest podcast.
Yes.
Wow. I don't know if y'all heard, Cardi B made a song about us. So that's out there for all you not young kids to check out. And my name's John. I'm here with Tiny.
Yep.
As always, except for the two episodes I missed way back when that dude thought they were really good.
John's been faithful.
I have.
I've had people say, Tiny, you do all the work on the show. You don't make John do nothing.
Nope.
And I'm like, who else am I going to find that's going to consistently every week make it a point to record with me?
I should use that as leverage going forward. That's right. Thank you for bringing that up. Yeah. I had a pretty spectacular week. I know your week was pretty eventful.
We
met a listener this week. Shout out to Dapper Dan, who came into town, and we ate barbecue with him. And then apparently you took him on some sort of guided tour around West Alabama.
I showed him some of Alabama's more, I can't say more notable sites because they're more hidden gems, I'll say.
I got a Patreon story, to tell in the Patreon about Malville. I can't tell it in the general public.
Okay.
All right. So remind me when we get there.
Gotcha.
Because Dapper will be in there. He'll like to hear about it too. I couldn't comment on the pictures he put up about it. So anyways, I got a big week. I got a bunch of stories that I'm narrowing down. I don't even know what to preview it with.
Wow.
I know one of them, we're going to talk about Hurricane Laura that hit down in the Gulf.
Yes.
I got a story about that. But that's the only one for sure I know I'm going to talk
about.
Sent from God. Yes, of course. I don't have any Falwell stories. I don't know if we want to touch on the Falwell controversy.
I didn't know if, because I don't have any actual articles to go off of, but I followed the story.
Yeah, me too.
And I don't know what we can say other than he behaves the way we expected him to.
I would say biggest piece of advice I could give to any married couple out there is don't hire a pool boy.
Unless you're into it, apparently.
Yeah, unless you're into it. Unless you like to wear your Speedo and sit in the corner. Okay?
Because
apparently his wife, too. I saw another story. His wife was hooking up with one of the other friends.
I've heard that story. Yeah. Yes. Okay?
I mean, definitely successful one time. Becky Falwell, apparently a little bit of a freak. Okay? And that's fine.
The pool boy, if I'm not mistaken, he claims that Jerry was all about
it. Oh, yeah, he was in on it. Now, Jerry says he was.
Yeah.
But he
was. That is what we call a cuckold, right?
I believe that's the proper term.
Yes.
I heard Dwight Schrute say that on The Office one time. So that's about my extent of the knowledge. But, so anyways, a little controversy with the dude that would get on the students for kissing on campus.
You think he would just leave.
Yeah, you just got to fade away.
He's already been pushed out by the board.
Yeah.
And he's been forced to resign.
Go make $10 million off of it, though.
Yes.
Yeah.
But he don't want to leave his office for some reason.
It's wild. Now, it's bizarre.
Maybe it's a super cool office.
Yeah.
But $10 million, you go set you up an office anywhere.
True.
Go set you up an office with a pool and a pool boy.
That's right. Yeah, you and Becky go do your thing however you want to. You know what I mean? I don't know. I don't think if Dieter ever came to me and was like, I want to start sleeping with a pool boy. My first question would be like, where's our pool? I would be down with it,
I would come home the next day wearing swimming trunks and like a pool skimmer.
I'd be like,
I would knock on the door and when she answered, be like, I'm here to inspect your pool, ma'am.
So anyways, so yeah, Falwell, he's having a little trouble. I don't think I would be into doing that with my wife. We tried a lot of stuff, you know, and we've always said yes to the other one's suggestions, no matter what it was.
Yeah.
My wife's more adventurous than people think she is, but I think I'd have to turn it down on that one.
Okay.
So that's what's up with Falwell. I just thought we'd touch on that because we're huge up at Liberty. They love us up there. They love us at Liberty.
Yeah, they do.
Maybe I can get on as a convocation speaker like Trump did.
Maybe.
Wouldn't that be amazing?
That would be so amazing.
I would make a lot of Baptist mad.
You're Dancing with the Stars. They need to.
What if Falwell ends up on Dancing with the Stars?
I don't think they would ever put him on there, but Becky might.
Oh, yeah. Yes, she might. He would definitely applaud from the audience.
He'd be all about it.
Yeah. So, yeah.
Well, anyway, so you got enough stories that you're just not even. You're going to hold us
so
in suspense.
Many stories.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, we are on my end. I want to talk about a man who tried to murder a 600-year-old tree.
Okay.
And then this was posted in the group, but there was a lady who was pronounced dead who woke up in the morgue.
Oh, wow.
That's horrifying.
That is very horrifying.
But I wanted to start with this, and as you all know, huge fan of Elon Musk.
Oh, yeah. Well, people forget we were an Elon Musk fanboy podcast before anything else,
I need to dig up that... I had a bumper for Elon stories. I need to dig that up and play it.
That's right. You did.
Yeah, here it is.
Yeah, we used to do Elon stories every week.
But eventually you can transform Mars into an Earth-like planet. The fast way and the slow way. The fast way is to drop thermonuclear weapons over the poles.
You're a super villain.
Well, he has debuted his Neuralink. Are you familiar with Neuralink?
I'm not. I assume it's an electric motorcycle?
No.
Okay.
This is a computer chip that he wants to put in people's brains.
Okay, he's the Antichrist.
That will allow people to interface with technology.
Oh, yeah, he's definitely the Antichrist. Yeah, gonna load up your currency on their necks. All right, I've already seen people talk about it. I thought Gates was the guy.
In Neuralink, they recently had a presentation they made where they showed this Neuralink. They showed it activating in, or what's the word I'm looking for? They showed it working in pigs. They put this Neuralink in pigs' brains, and then they were like, look, these pigs can play solitaire.
They're logging onto Facebook.
Yes. They're tweeting out anti-Trump memes.
That's right. You got to think the pigs would back the blue, though, right? You know? They'd be all for our police officers.
Yeah, I would assume so.
Yeah.
But, I mean, as many people on the left who are wanting to go vegan, and
that's true.
They might vote for the
people vote for their own self-interest. That's people true. Forget about that.
Well, anyway, this comes from Engadget, and this the article is "The Morning After: Elon Musk Brain Implant is Working in Pigs."
All right.
On Friday night, Elon Musk made good on his promise to show a working Neuralink device. The company announced that it successfully installed its Link hardware in the brains of pigs, and in one case removed the device without causing any obvious problems. The test subjects were present at the event, even if they weren't always cooperative. The Gertrude's Link seemed to successfully read signals generated by her neurons whenever she smelled a tasty treat. Musk once again made pie-in-the-sky promises about what this tech might do in the future. But the biggest advance we could see may be the prototype V2 surgical robot that helped to sew a 5-micron wide electrodes into a subject's brain.
Oh, wow.
So who's ready to be an early adopter? So
that's not me. You ain't put one in me ever. All right. I read Revelation.
That's what I say.
Yeah.
What would it take to get a chip in your brain? None. Never happened.
Yeah. No.
Okay.
Yeah.
I feel like the problem is, once you make that link between a brain and a computer, what's to stop someone from going through the computer into your brain?
That's right.
So to speak, you know?
Yeah, no, I know. They're going to be hacking your thoughts.
Yes. Yes.
I mean, I think some weird stuff. I don't need anybody else knowing about it. My Google search history is already going to get me in enough trouble when all that gets published.
Yeah.
So I don't want my thoughts doing it.
What about this robot that sews this stuff in people's brains?
Well, I'm all for robots doing whatever. Right. You know, I'm on board with the robots for when they take over. I want to have a record of them knowing. I'm fine with them.
A pet in your human zoo.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Just feed me. That's fine. But I think it's if it can sew very small, you know, little things, it made me think about the problem. When we were on Where is the Line podcast, shout out to them, a great podcast. We talked about doing a head transplant. Yes. One of the problems was getting all the nerves connected again. You know, now the dude claims he's got some kind of special stuff to do it with.
It's this magic glue.
Yeah, right.
That you put on the neurons and they grow back together.
But what if you had a robot that could do like super micro type work? Then we might be having head transplants.
Man, and then one day when I'm rich, I could kill Channing Tatum and have my head grafted on his body.
Okay. You want your head grafted on his body?
Yes.
I would take his head on my body. Just to freak people out. If you could, would that,
that would
be who you
definitely freak me out.
If you could get, that would be your choice, Channing Tatum?
Well, you know, I would probably have to sit down with a copy of E! Magazine and go through the male celebrities.
Okay.
But just off the top of my head.
I think I would do Michael Jordan.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, you can talk about freaking some people out. Look at my body with Michael Jordan's head on it.
Well, I was hoping that I could get a starring role in Magic Mike 3.
That's true. So, okay. That makes sense.
That was my
thought.
Is there
a sequel to the original Magic Mike?
Well, I don't know. Let me Google that real quick. I just assumed enough Lonely Housewives went to see the first did a sequel.
Oh, there were a lot of just even not Lonely Housewives who went, I think. But I was just surprised they didn't call me for the sequel. Magic Mike Lost in
there
Space.
There was Magic Mike XXL.
Okay. All right.
So I was hoping to
was
get
that
cast.
Big guys like me and you?
I was hoping to get cast in Magic Mike XXXL.
Now, that one may already be out there. I don't know. Well,
it's on Cinemax.
Comes on after 11 p.m.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I don't think I would get a chip at any time, you know? And I mean, I can't even get a tattoo voluntarily. So I'm certainly not going to get a chip voluntarily.
Right.
So that's where I stand on that.
Gotcha.
Well, let's talk about God.
Yes.
Okay. We are Christians. People forget.
I wonder why.
When I talk, people definitely forget. I just want people to see God work here, okay? And see how God works, all right? Hurricane Laura topples a Confederate statue after voters voted to keep it. Look at God go. All right?
Everyone talks about needing a sign.
Right.
Is this a sign?
Oh, what's the deal? This isn't even the full story. This is like a video story. Let me try to find it. Okay, here we go. So Hurricane Laura has toppled a Confederate statue that stood in front of the Lake Charles, Louisiana courthouse for more than 100 years. Erected in 1915, the South's Defenders Monument outlasted attempts to remove it 2 weeks ago, but it was knocked down by the powerful storm on Thursday. You know, some rednecks just mad about it.
Mad at the Lord.
One of the strongest hurricanes ever to strike the United States, Laura killed at least 6 people and destroyed property throughout Louisiana and Texas. The storm was a Category 4 hurricane when it passed over Lake Charles, where the monument stood. As recent Black Lives Matter protests have prompted a reckoning in the country, monuments dedicated to Confederates and controversial leaders have been taken down or forced governments to revisit their status. The officials in this parish down here where Lake Charles is voted 10-4 on August 13 to keep the statue on the grounds of the courthouse. One official told the AP that they asked for public comments and received 878 written responses against relocating the monument and only 67 in favor of removing it. So they've reached out, CBS News has reached out to these parish officials for a response on what the plans are for the statue, but haven't immediately gotten a response. Probably because they're dealing with the cleanup from a major hurricane that tore up the town.
If I was the one in charge, I would say, you know what? We're probably just going to leave it.
Yeah, down. Right. Yeah. Yes, right. So what's the saying about marriage? You know, what God put together, let no man put asunder. I think the reverse works.
What God tore down, let no man re-erect.
Right, yeah, right. Yeah. and just let it go. You just got to be like, well, this seems like a good time to not have to deal with this 5, 10, 20 years down the road.
Yes. So, thank you, Lord. You dealt with this problem for us.
That's right. Yes. Now, in Birmingham, the Lord dealt with it by a bunch of people just pulling it over. You know,
well,
right?
A bunch of people tried to pull
it over.
That's
true. They had trucks and stuff hooked up to it.
It didn't work.
Yeah.
I tell you what, those Confederate sisters or whatever,
they built a heck of a monument in there. Yeah, they did.
The mayor came and told the crowd, hey, if everyone will go home, I'll get a crane we'll get it taken down tomorrow.
Stop burning the tires off of your life. 84 GMC truck trying to pull this thing down, chain breaking. Let's just get some professionals in to do it.
Yes.
Yeah. But, you know, Confederate monuments, pretty big issue down here in the South.
Yes.
I don't think they're an issue in other parts of the country, right? They don't have Confederate art monuments in Portland, right?
Probably not.
Yeah, I wouldn't think so.
I wouldn't think so.
Now, there are people mad out in Portland. I got a story I could do about that later, too.
Do you think the... Well, I just don't know. I was wondering, you know, you would think with all the protests and everything going on, you know, you would wonder why our cities aren't burning.
Yeah,
like,
well,
they are
right
up north. Yeah.
You talking about the,
now, I don't
the cradle
give you,
of the Confederacy and home of Jim Crow, Alabama's not having major riots. It's wild.
I don't want to give anybody any ideas here, which is why last time we talked about this, we kind of shot ourselves in the foot.
True.
But
that's true. We might have one bust out in Tuscaloosa tomorrow. You better watch out.
Which that was in Birmingham. I know here in Tuscaloosa, we've had two or three protests.
Yeah, but they're all
and amazingly, no one has managed to set anything on fire. Nobody's tore nothing up.
No graffiti.
No one's been shot. No one is, you know, no 17-year-olds patrolling with AR-15s.
Oh, wow. Don't get started on that.
Yes.
That touched some nerves right there.
It does.
What was that kid's name? Kyle something?
Kyle Rittenhouse or something like that, yeah.
He was about it, you know, like he went up in there. It's like, I'm going to show y'all what's going on. All these middle-aged Facebook men on my Facebook talk about what y'all would do. This 17-year-old kid's more of a man than y'all are. I'm not saying he's right. I'm not saying he's wrong.
Yeah.
I'm saying y'all do a lot of talking, no action. This kid got about it, okay?
Here's my thoughts on the whole situation. If you attack somebody, you shouldn't be surprised that they shoot at you.
Oh, yeah. Right.
That said, if you go looking for trouble, you're probably going to find it.
You hang out on Trouble Street, trouble's going to come home sooner or later.
I was about to say, that's why I stay home.
I had a conversation with my 15-year-old son, Thomas, about it. And I said, what do you think about all this? And he was like, well, I think you would be really dumb to attack someone with a gun. He was like, regardless of the circumstances, regardless of right and wrong, it's just pretty dumb to attack somebody with a gun. Mm-hmm. I was like, I've done a good job raising this kid so far.
Yes.
Like, if you got that much common sense, we're okay.
Well, you know, there have been, I hate to say this, but there's been a lot of people take guns in places who were not provoked.
Sure, right.
Who just shot up a bunch of people for
absolutely.
No reason because they were crazy.
Yeah.
Just because they wanted to and they were evil.
Well, and there's something to be said for the counter argument to Mr. Kyle here is that some of these people were trying to prevent him from killing more folks and chasing him, which is heroic in some situations. So, I don't know about all
of
it.
I'm not a lawyer.
And I haven't even kept up with all of it other than I've seen a mutual friend of ours on Facebook. You know exactly who I'm talking
exactly
about.
I know exactly what you're talking about. I have seen some memes
that
I will never share.
Never.
With anybody.
No. But he will. He will with, I think he doesn't care.
He's trying to get, he's trying to get time
it's like,
out.
Well, it's like, man, what do you, like, have you no decency? That's what I want to say. Like, look, man, I get you may be on one side of the argument. I may be on the other side, whatever. But have you no decency? People have died here.
Apparently
no
not.
Reason to rub it in.
Well, my next story here comes from Michigan Live. Michigan woman discovered alive at funeral home was in a body bag for 2 hours.
Wow. Okay.
I mean,
that's a good nap.
That sounds like something that, what's his name, McCamey Manor would do.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Anyway, and this one got shared up in the group. I don't remember who posted it. But
me either, but it was there.
Props to whoever posted this up. This was in Southfield, Michigan. The Michigan woman pronounced dead by paramedics, even though she was still alive, was in a body bag for 2 hours before she was found, according to the Associated Press.
You know the paramedics boss, got to call those guys into his office.
They're fired, right?
Yeah, right. Hey, guys, tell me what happened with Ms. Johnson.
Tamisha Beecham, 20, from Southfield, was found breathing with her eyes open after the body bag was opened at the funeral home. You know, imagine the dude running the funeral home who sees this thing moving around.
Yeah, no, he's freaking out.
Oh, my goodness.
I'd have hit it with a bat a few times before I open it up, just to make sure you never know.
Yeah. Like, is this how it starts?
Yeah,
is this how the zombie apocalypse starts?
That's exactly right.
Beecham is on a respirator in critical condition at Sinai Grace Hospital in Detroit. Her family has now hired Jeffrey Figger as their attorney, who says he is investigating negligence into the August 23rd incident, where, according to WDIV-TV Local 4 News, Beecham was found in cardiac arrest before being declared dead and taken to a local funeral home. She was alive, her eyes were open, and she was breathing, said Figger, describing how Beecham was found at the funeral home. My recollection is that the embalmer was actually there, and he was the person who opened the body bag. Nightmares.
That's right.
She needed medical treatment and needed transportation to a hospital, but got transportation to a funeral home. The city of Southfield is doing its own internal investigation and says the fire and police departments followed procedures. Here is Southfield Fire Department's statement to WDIV-TV. When paramedics arrived, they found a 20-year-old who was not breathing. The paramedics performed CPR and other life-reviving methods for 30 minutes. Given medical readings and the condition of the patient, it was determined at the time that she did not have signs of life. Because there was no indication of foul play as per standard operating procedure, the Oakland County Medical Examiner's Office was contacted, and given the medical data, the patient was again determined to have expired, and the body was released directly to the family to make arrangements with a funeral home of their choosing. So that's crazy.
Yeah. What do you think when you wake up in there? You just got to be like, this is the end, I guess. Are they going to bury me alive like David Blaine?
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. You know, like,
is it possible that she was dead? And
yeah.
Maybe she just kind of, we do know.
The Lord brought her back.
I was going to say.
We're going to get a 6 Minutes in Heaven movie out of this bad boy. I can't wait to see Kirk Cameron and his wife in it.
We know from science that death is not an event like we see in movies where someone kind of closes their eyes and goes to sleep, but it's that process.
Right.
And sometimes it can be a long process.
Sure.
When a human body expires.
Right.
So maybe something happened and she was able to.
She came back.
Bounce back. I don't know. I tell you what, that's crazy that you wake up in a body bag.
You better believe it.
Golly.
You better believe it. Let's move on out to Portland.
Okay.
We mentioned Portland a
little
earlier.
Do we have
to? Yeah. Been a lot of rioting out in Portland, right?
Mostly peaceful.
Oh, mostly peaceful.
Now, fiery,
now,
but mostly. Did you see that headline?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I hate to bring this up, but
yeah, I saw that
and I thought, well, now this is a true but mostly false headline.
True. Well, this comes from Salon.com. Everybody knows Salon.com. Loves Trump. Loves our police. Loves the American ideals that the country was founded on.
Yes.
Okay. So much tear gas has been sprayed on Portland protesters that officials fear it's polluted the water.
Dang.
That's got to be a lot of tear gas.
That's
got to
be a lot, because tear gas is not, like, it comes out as a gas.
Yeah.
The only way it gets into the water is maybe it rains, like it condenses and falls down back down with the rain, maybe.
Yeah. I don't know. Because I didn't read this. I don't really know yet. We're about to find out together.
Okay.
Police in Portland peppered protesters. Wow, that's a tongue twister. Police in Portland peppered protesters with tear gas on Monday as they assembled outside of a police station following a weekend of ongoing demonstrations against police racism and in favor of defunding the police. Their actions continue a history of Portland police using tear gas on demonstrators, tracing as far back as May. They made headlines last month after federal law enforcement began detaining protesters. Now, we all heard about that. That's the people rolling up in unmarked vehicles, taking them. Now, I know there's been some criticism of that, but I've been pulled over by an unmarked vehicle before.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know what the legalities is on that. But that was my number one thought. I was like, do they not have unmarked police where y'all are? They do down here all the time. So I don't know.
Yeah, and I will say that these people who are arrested and detained, it's not like we never hear from them again.
Sure.
You know, they're typically charged and then bailed out or whatever.
I don't know.
So.
That's why I'm not a dictator. We'd never hear from them again. Protesters and activists alike are fearful for the long-term effects of being exposed to chemical weapons. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
chemical weapon seems a little strong of a way to put it, but okay.
We went to war with Iraq over chemical weapons.
That's right.
That they didn't have.
People forget they didn't have them. Yeah.
Yeah.
Are we all the way out of Iraq now? I think we're all the way done with that over there, aren't we?
Yeah, because I know we moved out and ISIS moved right back in.
Exactly.
Remember?
Yeah, that's so, true.
Yes, we are out.
Okay, that's fine. Good. I'm anti-war. People don't know. I'm anti-war. Okay.
We told the Iraqi government, good luck.
Yeah. So the Oregon Department of Environmental Quality noted previously there is no scientific precedent for the long-term exposure of tear gas on humans, as it is not meant to be used often. And the amount of the causistic gas, reportedly the variant known as CS gas, sprayed in downtown Portland is similarly unusual. Nearly every night since the week of George Floyd's death on May 25th, tear gas has coated the sidewalks and drains.
Wow.
Okay, so it says, this is a really long article. Let me get over here
just
to the meat
high
of
points,
it.
Yeah,
right.
CS gas, that's what they hit Waco with, right?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, that's some bad stuff. This is,
yeah, they didn't play around in Waco.
Serious.
Yeah. No, they also had all kinds of crimes to cover up there.
I was about to say, after the gas settles, they say that it leaves a dust-like residue on everything, which is very flammable.
Okay. Well, so, that's what they're saying here. All right. And it says...
maybe that's why there's been so many fiery protests.
It says... Portland's ongoing efforts to manage municipal stormwater discharges, the Oregon Department of Environmental Quality sent a letter to Portland's Bureau of Environmental Services. Due to the unprecedented amount, this is a quote, of tear gas products used in the downtown area over the last 90 days, DEQ is requiring the city to conduct additional water quality monitoring. They added that the city must submit a monitoring plan within 3 weeks of the letter's date. In addition, the authorities require Portland to engage in water quality monitoring at areas where heavy rain may cause tear gas to discharge into the Willamette River, as well as monitor at the closest upstream and downstream outfalls that do not collect stormwater from the downtown area. Anyways, crap load of tear gas on these people, yes. And I think it may hurt the water up there. So, I mean...
What's the answer? I have no answers.
Well, there's two answers, I think. Number one... Quit using tear gas. Mm-hmm. All right. That's a simple one.
Okay.
Number two, quit protesting. You know, I mean, I quit protesting in a manner that would require tear gas.
Yeah, I'm all for protesting. Let's quit the riot.
I'm all for riot. I don't mind riots. I went on record. I don't mind, especially burning down government buildings and stuff. No, I think that's where it's at.
But not private property.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I feel like our founding fathers would be on board with burning down your police station mm-hmm. if you think your police are doing wrong.
Right.
You know?
Yes.
But I don't think they would be for burning
Meemaw
down.
Meemaw and Peepaw's Diner.
Yeah, right. Yes. Meemaw and Peepaw's Diner. Because mm-hmm. they ain't doing nothing.
No.
You know? And I get, hey, man, a lot of this stuff is built up over time and it's emotions. Mm-hmm. And sometimes things happen. And sometimes some people are just down there to cause trouble.
Yeah.
I mean, we got to admit it, right?
The agent provocateur.
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm. Let's keep the tear gas from being used
right.
would be one solution. And the other would be, let's not use tear gas.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of weird that we got to use tear gas on citizens of the United States, but whatever, you know. That's a whole nother debate, I think, to be had.
Do you think we could use massive amounts of...
lead? That would work.
Well, I was going to say...
Okay, sorry. I was going in the wrong direction.
High velocity lead.
Yeah. That'll end a protest.
I was going to say maybe a pepper spray.
Maybe so.
Yeah.
Then what if all your water is like spicy from now on because you used a bunch of pepper spray?
Yeah.
That'd be kind of cool. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what you do. I know these guys, some of these, from what I've read,
mm-hmm.
These people have kind of figured out ways to get around the tear gas. Not necessarily gas masks, but definitely covering their face and all that.
Yeah, if you wet a bandana,
yeah.
entire well like a mask, like mm-hmm. everyone has to wear anyway, it does right. it kind of blocks it out somewhat.
Right. Yeah, it lessens the effect. I think
you can continue screaming and light stuff on fire,
throwing trash cans yeah. and everything. Yeah, I don't know.
Anyway.
I mean, it's kind of a strange world we live in now.
It is. I mean, it is.
Things have been pretty calm in Northport. You know, so far so good.
It makes me so scared to hear you say that.
If one breaks out, that's fine. I'm going to Fayette. You know,
they just don't come to my house.
No, I ain't heading that way. I'm heading north. I would not cross the river.
No, I was
talking
about the protesters. Oh, yeah. Please don't come to my house.
Well, I mean, are we getting out of town if it gets that way? If it gets that bad,
right?
I'm people forget I'm a little bit of a prepper too. Okay, so I'm prepared.
But what happens if another protest breaks out in Fayette?
Well, they're gonna have to come a long way to get us in Fayette. Saying,
what if they're mad because they took down a Confederate statue? Right.
I don't know if there is a Confederate statue at the Fayette Courthouse.
I don't have no idea.
I was thinking about that the other day, and I don't remember one. I know there's one for the
one in
veterans.
Carrollton.
Yeah. Oh, they're definitely right up front. There's one in Carrollton. But I was like, I know there's one for the veterans who died in wars, but I don't know if there's a Confederate one there or not. Wouldn't surprise me if there is one. But also wouldn't surprise me if Fayette would just take it down and not make a big deal out of it, because Fayette is, for a small town, I've always felt was pretty progressive, you know, in a lot of ways. Now, I'm saying that as a white dude, so I'm sure it's different through other lenses.
Right. Well, John, what do you think about killing trees?
I'm not for killing trees. Mm-hmm. Never have been, unless it's necessary. No,
when the trees are getting out of line.
Well, there are things like, okay, for forestry reasons, you might need to thin a forest out. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe that a tree is posing a danger by like hanging over your roof or something. But in general, I'm not for just, let's just go out and cut trees to cut trees.
Well, we need toilet paper.
Sure. Yeah. And that's part of forestry, you know, that you would have to do. A well-managed forest system is a beautiful thing.
And we need to build shopping malls.
Yeah.
We got to build furniture stores.
Absolutely.
Sometimes for that
gotta
requires
build furniture.
Cutting down trees. Yep.
Got to build furniture.
That's right.
Yeah.
Well, what would you think about this guy who tried to kill a 600-year-old tree?
Depends on why. And I'll say trees are a renewable resource. People forget.
Yeah, that's true.
Right.
You can plant more of them.
Yeah.
But it is like, how do you know that tree is 600 years old?
Will you do a core sample? Not the rocket science.
Does the core sample not kill the tree, though?
No. People do cores. We did one out at Lake Lurline the other week.
Okay, cool. Yeah. Well, anyway, hush my mouth. I don't know what I'm talking about.
Golly, Tiny. He was so ignorant.
Well, anyway, we're going to talk about a guy who tried to kill a 600-year-old tree. This is on this comes from CNN. So it could be fake news.
Yeah, definitely could be.
But
According to the president, it is.
Yes. In May 1989, a bizarre murder attempt in Austin, Texas, gripped the nation and made worldwide news. The details of the case were unusual and unlike anything police had seen before. The victim, Austin's oldest resident, a nearly 600-year-old tree known as Treaty Oak.
Treaty Oak.
Treaty Oak is a spectacular specimen. It is centuries older than the city it resides in and stretches out to a spread of nearly 100 feet. In the 1920s, the American Forestry Association named the treaty oak the most perfect specimen of a tree in North America.
Ooh.
And thanks to a citywide fundraiser in the 1930s, the tree even owns the park that it lives on.
Oh, wow. So they signed the land over to the tree.
Yes.
Okay.
What if the tree, like, turned around and sold the land to some development company for a huge profit?
Yeah. So why is the dude trying to kill the tree? That's what I need to know.
Certainly, there are not many trees, not just in Austin or in Texas, but in the world that own their own land, said John Detratus, Austin's first city forester. Come on down here. In 1989, Detratus was hosting a group of state foresters from across the country and took them on a tour of Austin's parks. When they got to Treaty Oak, they noticed dead grass on the ground surrounding the tree. I just assumed it was a parks employee that got a little sloppy, and I didn't give it a second thought. But months later, the tree continued to deteriorate, and the leaves began to show symptoms of chemical poisoning.
Oh, no.
Or herbicide.
Oh, no. Texas does have a winning record against Alabama.
I can think of one suspect.
No, I can't too. He's went on to be with the Lord, or he's went on to the great beyond, wherever that may be.
This is in 1989.
Oh, okay.
So,
well, yeah, he may have been out there. I wonder if we played Texas in 89.
I don't know. So right away, we dug up some of the soil and took some tissue samples and sent it off to a laboratory. A week or two later, we got the results back that the treaty oak had been poisoned.
Oh, no.
The poison detected was a powerful herbicide known as Velpar, manufactured by a chemical company, DuPont, usually used to kill hardwoods on pine plantations. We knew that it was an intentional poisoning, and that is when the fun started, said Detritus. As far as he knew, no one had ever tried to solve a problem quite like this before. It began to make national and international news. It became the most famous tree in the world. Front page of the Times, it was in Sports Illustrated, People Magazine, National Geographic, and it was on all the networks. People from all over the world became invested in the case. People started hearing about it, and one of the people to hear about it was H. Ross Perot. Perot was a billionaire and a business magistrate based in Texas, and he offered to help with the expenses of the investigation. He came to us and said, whatever it takes, however long it takes, you just send me the bill. With Perot's blank check in hand, Detritus and his team went on to call every expert and scientist in their Rolodex. It says here that the case became an international sensation. There was a former undercover cop who took on the case. As Treaty Oak continued to receive media coverage, a woman by the name of Cindy Blanco came forward claiming to have information pertaining to the case. Blanco was acquainted with a man named Paul Stedman Cullen, who she had carpooled to a local methadone clinic. During their car rides, Blanco said that Cullen spoke about his love for his mental health counselor, who wasn't returning the same affections.
Oh, that'll happen. Happens to all of us, right?
Blanco alleged that Cullen had searched for books on witchcraft, looking for an anti-love spell to mend his broken heart. So instead of casting a love spell on her, he's going to cast a hate spell on himself to help him get over his counselor. Although the details of the ritual he chose to remain unclear on, Blanco claimed that Cullen believed that by killing a living tree, he would also be killing his love for his mental health care counselor.
Okay.
As Jones remembered it, he said, well, let me pick the biggest thing around here and kill it, and as it decomposes, so will my love for her. But without evidence or admission of guilt, Jones could not make an arrest, so he pulled from his experience as an undercover cop to get the information he needed. With Blanco, he had the perfect informant. We wired her up and sent her out, and she gathered the evidence for us. It was like putting a dollar in a jukebox. Based on what Cullen had told her on the wire, we went and got an arrest warrant. And when I went and got an evidentiary search warrant to search his residence, his truck, at Cullen's home, police found a stack of books covering everything from religion to quantum mechanics, a .22 caliber rifle, and dirt samples to test for Velpar. With the mounting evidence against him, the trial seemed like an open and shut case, but because of a prior conviction, Cullen faced the possibility of serving life in prison. While Cullen maintained his innocence throughout the case, his alleged admission of guilt on the tapes with Blanco became the damaging piece of evidence against him, and he was found guilty and sentenced to 9 years in prison. He served only 3 of those 9 years when he was released. He spent the remainder of his life in California, where he passed away in 2001.
Okay.
So.
And you said this happened in 83?
89.
89. So. We lost, Alabama lost to Texas in the 1982 Cotton Bowl. So I was thinking, could be Updike.
I was about to say, did he not? Says he passed away in 2001. Maybe he faked his death, changed his name to Harvey Updike,
and now he's
and moved to Montgomery.
That's true,
Alabama.
Yeah, Texas has a 7-1-1 record against Alabama.
Wow.
So, yeah,
interesting.
Now we beat them in the national championship game.
Yeah, we did.
Everybody likes to say if Colt McCoy would have played, we would have lost. But whatever, he didn't play. He got hurt. You know?
Yeah.
Hey, my fault, Marcel Darius hits hard.
Took him out of the game.
That's right.
Yeah, hard to throw them touchdown passes when you can't, you know what I mean?
When your shoulder in your arm. That's right. Yeah, I'm sorry. Clean hit. That's just the way it goes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well,
but
I mean,
for people who don't know about Harvey Updike, maybe there's some people out there. Here in Alabama, you may have heard us mention before, we have a college football team here, Alabama.
That's true. We have 2 college football teams in this state.
That's true.
Both are immensely popular. One of them a little more popular than the other one. But,
and there's a huge rivalry.
Yes, there is.
And there
some people take it super serious. Mm-hmm. Like the people that, like if you post anything about Alabama on your Facebook or Twitter or whatever that come on and be like Auburn this or whatever. Those people, you're like, you need to dial it back a little bit, buddy. Okay?
Yeah.
Like, I'm not coming on you Auburn stuff talking about Alabama. Just dial it back. We get it. You like Auburn, you know?
Yeah.
Those people are like, the guy we were talking about earlier, which we probably, We probably chopped that out of show. The one that's posted all the really offensive memes.
Yeah.
He's one of the worst at it.
Yes.
Anyways.
But we had a, down in Auburn, they have a tradition.
Yes.
There's a drugstore called Toomer's, and there's some oak trees, or there used to be some oak trees.
Not sure what the status is on them now.
Where the students would roll the trees after big wins and such.
Right. With toilet paper.
With toilet paper.
Right.
And then there was a guy named Harvey Updike who poisoned those trees. He got mad
because they hung a Cam Newton jersey on Bear Bryant statue.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Which really
not a big
wasn't
deal.
Even that big a prank.
No. But you know who Harvey Updike is? He's the guy that goes on your friends who post Auburn stuff and post Alabama stuff. That's the type of dude he was. Okay.
So he gets mad and he decides to poison those trees.
Right.
And then he called into a popular talk show.
That's true.
Paul Feinbaum to brag about it.
Back when it was local.
Back before he was on ESPN.
Yeah. He said he had too much Bama in him. He just couldn't stop himself.
Hilarious local story.
Well, I mean, I'm not for the trees. I don't want anybody killing Auburn's trees. That dude, he deserved every bit of punishment he got. And I don't think he paid back any money that he was supposed to pay to them.
He got a huge, fine that he was supposed to pay. And but like you said,
he ever did.
I don't think he could have paid it if he wanted it. He's just enormous.
He's just broke anyways.
He spent some time in prison.
Spent a little time in jail. And now he's dead. So. Ding dong, the witch is dead. I'm sure Auburn fans are happy about that. And I don't really care.
Me either.
People are always like, Alabama fans do a bunch of stupid stuff. I'm like, I don't care. I can't control other people's actions.
Every group out there has their nuts, so to speak. Right. There's no group out there that is completely devoid of idiots.
I have a lot of good friends that love Auburn, and I don't hate Auburn by any means. I mean, some people hate Auburn.
My dad does.
Yeah. I mean, they ain't want nothing to do with it. I don't hate Auburn at all. Uh-huh. It's fine with me. If Auburn does great, that's fine. I don't care. But I have some friends that'll be like, Alabama fans got the trashiest fans in the whole, world or whatever. And I'm like, you realize we're all from the same state, right? You guys just aren't
Yes.
We didn't get all the trashy ones. Y'all got a few, okay? We got a bunch of white trash idiots all over from both ends of the state. Yes. And they root for both of our teams. Yep. So that's just the way it goes. Mm-hmm. We make a lot of news, though, because we're, quite frankly,
about it.
Yeah, we're a little insane about it, and we're pretty popular. Alabama moves the needle on a news story. Everybody gets to talk about it because we won a lot here lately. Mm-hmm. Now, let us go back to sucking like it did when Shula was here and people were shooting folks after games and everything. Nobody really even cared outside of state Alabama.
Right.
So that's just how it goes.
Well, anyway, I'm done.
Oh, yeah. So. I got one more, though.
Okay.
Great one. Gonna just give a shout out to my Catholic brothers and sisters at the top of the story right here. This is from the Jerusalem Post.
Okay.
Okay. Jesus's favorite newspaper. Okay. The Vatican has declared the Blues Brothers a Catholic classic.
Nice.
The Vatican newspaper L'Osservatore Romano has declared the 1980 film The Blues Brothers a recommended film for Catholics on Sunday. The comedy starring John Belushi and Dan Aykroyd features two brothers who say they're on a mission from God. The pair battle police, country fans, and neo-Nazis to save a Catholic orphanage in Chicago where they grew up. Aykroyd told the New York Post that as a former altar boy, but a somewhat lapsed Catholic, I was delighted with the endorsement. The movie, which the newspaper called incredibly shrewd, joins the Passion of the Christ and the Ten Commandments, amongst others, on the Vatican's recommended film list. That's all the article has to say, which is enough. I love the Blues Brothers. I may convert right now to Catholicism. I think you got to take a test or something, right?
No, you don't have to take a test.
Is there you got to learn the history of the church type thing?
Okay.
I don't know. I have no clue.
If there is, this is news to me. I didn't think there was.
I don't know, really. Okay. I mean, can you just go up? It's like here, if you can make it to the front of the church and last through the handshake line.
If you can sign your name on that membership card.
You're in, right? You ain't got to know nothing about nothing, right?
Yeah.
I don't know if it is or not. I just may have made that up in my head. I don't know.
Well, now I know that there's certain there's confirmation and things like
yeah,
that.
Yeah,
that
that's
through.
Kind of what I'm talking about. Yeah,
yeah, but I don't think it's a test. I don't think it's a written test.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't think that. But you just got to learn about the history of the church, which they tried a little bit of that. I don't think they tried it here, but other Baptist churches are doing like a
new believers class.
Yeah, like a 101. Yeah, right. These are what Baptists are for. Like, can't drink Pepsi, can't go to Target, can't go to Disney World, right? That's what they cover in there, I imagine, right?
No, it's nothing like that.
Oh, that's what in my mind, that's how I would have taught it.
It's far
no
more.
No dancing, no drinking, okay?
It's far more basic.
Only,
things like
only missionary position, sexual relations, right? This is the stuff that we cover in here. Yeah.
I like the Blues Brothers.
It's a great movie. It is a great movie. One of my favorite movies of all time.
Now, I would think if the Catholic was endorsing it, they would have endorsed a like a VidAngel edit of the movie.
Yes. All right.
Maybe not the uncut version.
Yeah, you know, I don't know. A little bit of language in there, but it's okay.
It's it's,
they're a little more lax on that than we are.
That's
right?
True.
Yeah.
That's very true.
They understand. You can get forgiveness. Right. Sure.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Now, well, you can get forgiveness from God.
Yeah.
Now, your Sunday school teacher another story.
They're going to bring it up every Sunday. Right. Yeah. Well, one thing I'm thankful for, along with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the Blues Brothers, is world-famous Cajun Curl Bayou Blended Spice. And we want to thank them for their support. Check them out at CajunCurl.com. You can order the spice and their Cajun Curl cutter for potatoes all on CajunCurl.com. It was created on the Elm Bayou in Evangeline Parish, Louisiana, and it's the seasoning that goes on everything. If you like cooking or eating, this is a spice for you. Cajun Curl Bayou Blended Spice goes well with chicken, beef, pork, potatoes, and anything else you can think of putting it on. You know, not a bad idea up in Portland. Spray the protesters with Cajun Curl. Yeah, they're tasty. They're like, get hungry, go home.
Yeah.
Yeah, not a bad idea. Well, their spiral potato cutter is absolutely amazing. It's easy to use, it's easy to clean, and it will allow you to make your own chips using the Cajun Curl spice. If you want to turn your next Antifa rally up a notch, imagine whipping up a batch of homemade potato chips. The police aren't going to be able to top that. And let me tell you, the homemade chips with Cajun Curl Bayou Blended Spice on them will change your life. On the website, CajunCurl.com, you can not only order the original Bayou Blended Spice, but the Cajun Curl chip cutter as well. And you'll also find recipes that are absolutely mind-blowing. You can locate your nearest retailer or order your own. If your local grocer doesn't carry world-famous Cajun Curl Bayou Blended Spice, ask them to start stocking it now. Here locally in Tuscaloosa and Northport, it's available at the Piggly Wiggly on Lurleen Wallace Boulevard, Mark's Mart in downtown Northport, South's Finest Meats, and Vowels Fresh Market on Skyland Boulevard. All of their products are made in the USA, so not only do you enjoy the taste of Cajun Curl, but you also feel patriotic while you enjoy your meal. It's all natural, low salt, and it has a little kick to it, but it doesn't burn your lips. Listen up. World-famous Cajun Curl Bayou Blended Spice. Taste the spice, but not the heat. Check them out, CajunCurl.com, and use our promo code EOP10. That's EOP and the number 10 to get a 10% discount.
Because we ask that you use the spice, but we don't ask you to pay full price.
That's right.
All right, John, what do you say we go to the phones?
Let's go. I bet you I could guess who called.
I bet you can't.
Okay. I would say either Nate or Jacqueline.
Okay, maybe you can. Our first call comes from Nicole.
Oh, Nicole. All right.
Hadn't called
in
a while.
One of my favorites. She's a top 10 listener to me.
Absolutely.
Hey, John and Tiny, or Tiny and John. I don't know who's more important.
Tiny.
Probably Tiny, since he's the one who's making the podcast happen.
That's right.
This is Nicole from California. And I just wanted to say that I equally enjoy the banter and also the odd stories. I even enjoy the sports talk.
Nice.
Not okay. That I actually understand what you're talking about, because I don't follow college football, but it makes me laugh because, I don't know, I still think it's funny. And I will say that if I could have a urinal in my bathroom at home, I would totally do that. just because I have little boys and I feel like maybe it would help, like, the spray factor.
Yeah.
I think a urinal in my house would be great. My husband's actually the one who thinks it's pointless. So I don't know, just a different opinion there. Thanks, guys. Awesome content as usual. Bye.
Thank you so much, Nicole. Yeah. She is on point.
She, you know what? Biggest Instagram fan we got.
Yes.
You know? Biggest Instagram fan. And that's why I love her.
Yeah.
Also love that she enjoys the sports talk. Speaking of which, college football started back last night. Austin Peay versus Central Arkansas.
Yes.
Which kid from Fett's on Austin Peay?
Really?
People don't know.
How about that? Yeah.
I went to high school with his daddy, Sugar Man. What's up? Shout out to Sugar Man. People don't know him, but he doesn't listen either, I don't think. But in case he ever hears.
Hey, if you do listen, call into the show.
Yeah, that'd be great. We'll be the official podcast of the Austin Peay Colonels or whatever y'all are.
And what is up with her husband saying no to the urinal? Maybe he just don't want to have the hassle of doing it. Maybe
you got young boys. I have young boys.
Yes.
You know, I mean, they don't put the firemen trainees on the big hose to begin with. You know, they got to get used to the little ones. So maybe once you get used, like me and you, we're used to the big hose.
Yes.
And we're not making a big mess.
Mm-hmm.
But for the trainees, they're not always getting it like they need to get it because they're just getting familiar with the equipment. And everything.
Right.
So maybe he's forgotten the struggle.
Maybe.
I don't know.
Well, anyway, and then we've also got a call from our old buddy Nate.
All right.
You're talking about, this is Nathan. You're talking about what can mosquitoes do to me? Since you guys talked about the Where's the Line podcast, I've listened to some of those. And if you can't get through a whole episode of those, you're a sissy.
Oh, okay. Shots fired.
Look, buddy. All right. I know you're young. All right. You got to start buying your own clothes before you can call me a sissy. All right. That's number one. Number two, you've never even made another human. I've made three of them. Okay. So I am definitely not a sissy. All right. I don't know what you're talking about. I may have a weak stomach, but that don't make me a sissy. Okay. No, that's just what it is. Okay. Can't talk about me till you buy your own clothes.
Come on, John. You can listen to a whole episode of that. I've listened to like three in a row.
Good for you.
But there is one with mosquitoes called the yellow fever, and it's even today it's almost impossible to get rid of. There's a 50% death rate or something. And I really hope that there's football in at least in Wisconsin so I can play football. But my team doesn't have a coach right now.
I'll come coach.
So I'm just hoping that I get to play football. Alright. Be afraid of mosquitoes. It's also them. They can kill you. Malaria and all that. Alright. Well, talk to you later. Or listen to you talk. Listen to you.
Don't hurt yourself, bud.
Listen to you listening to me and commentating on my voicemail.
All right.
Stop talking. Bye.
Okay.
All right. First things first. He is true. He's absolutely true. Mosquitoes. I mean, I know we talk about hippos being the animal that attacks and kills more people.
Sure.
But if you want to get technical, I think it actually is mosquitoes from disease.
Yeah, no, I agree.
More humans die from mosquitoes every year than any other animal.
Not a huge problem in the United States as it is in other parts of the world.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if we can rid the world of mosquitoes.
That's right. Then we're going to have like another killer species
then we'll
come
have
up.
We'll have an overpopulation of humans.
That's true. Right. Yeah. It's all about balance. Yeah. Right.
And then also the Where's the Line podcast. Yeah, Kevin does an excellent podcast. It is not for the faint of heart.
No, it's not.
He did a three-part episode on the yellow fever, which is, it is. We talk about coronavirus and how scary it is, but it ain't got nothing on yellow fever.
Okay.
Where you basically vomit black. It's like your organs that you're puking up.
Okay.
And until you die. You puke until you die.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
Still hasn't been cured. Now it's been mostly contained because through vaccines and whatnot, and we know what spreads it and things, but Yeah, it can. If there's ever an outbreak of that stuff, it would still be really bad today.
True. Well, I would recommend everybody listen to Where Is the Line.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Kevin has the best voice.
He does.
I mean, it's amazing when I hear it. He intros the Patreon section. You should join up just to listen to that.
Just to hear his intro.
Right. Great voice. Yeah. Oh, and Nate, I hope you get to play football too. I hope you find a coach. If you can't, you know, let's talk some money. You know, get the school board in touch with me. I'll come up there. We're going to run the triple option. All right. And we're going to smack people in the face. All right. We're going to do is spreading it out and throwing the ball. I hate that we throw the ball at Alabama. You know, like when Saban first got here, we just run over people. Mm-hmm. It's so great. I'm not Nick Saban. He can coach the team however he wants to. But I wish we'd still run over people.
It made for quick games, too.
Yeah, right. I know.
That clock stayed running.
That's right. Yes.
That clock was always ticking.
Yep.
Well, John, I don't know about you, but I would like to thank all of the patrons of this show.
Absolutely.
I would specifically like to thank by name those who donate at the 10 or above tier. And they are Mr. Daniel Hendrick, Mr. James White, Mr. Chris Tipton, Mr. Derek Reeves, Ms. Sharon Craig. Dapper Man came to see us last week.
That's right.
We actually recorded a show together. That'll be coming out at some point.
Okay.
When I get some time.
I wasn't in on that. Surprise, surprise.
Mr. J.D. Westfall, Ms. Jackie B., Mr. Todd Glover, Mr. Tyler Bond, Mr. Thomas Williams, Ms. Sherry Heron, Ms. Jane Updegraff, and Mike W.,
McWheel.
A.K.A. McWheel.
McWheel.
Thank you so much for donating to the show and just giving us an opportunity to keep this show going, give us a reason to soldier on, invest in advertising, new equipment, and just keep this show rolling.
Yeah. We appreciate it. Your support is immeasurable.
Mm-hmm.
Much more than the sticker you received in the mail.
Yes.
It was how much we think of you.
Go to, if you would like to get in on this,
sure.
Go to patreon.com/earthoddity. We have 4 different tiers. You can sign up wherever you want to. But if you sign up at the $5 tier, you get an extended show every single week.
Yeah.
And once a month, we're going to be recording that here in a minute, you get an all-exclusive patrons-only episode.
Wow. It's going to be great.
Now, Dapper Man told me to shout this out. Let me just tell you how this works, okay? You go to the website. You sign up to be a Patreon. You get an email with a custom RSS link.
Okay.
You copy that link, you search in your podcatcher of choice that you post that link, that is your link, and it'll bring up an exclusive feed that is just for the patrons.
Okay. Now,
most all podcatchers will allow the addition of custom feeds, but not all of them do. One of those is Spotify.
Oh, wow.
If you are one of those people, then you can either just simply use another podcatcher app, or if it would be easier, just download the Patreon app on Android or iPhone, and you can just listen to us on Patreon.
Okay.
So, super simple.
Wow.
Anybody can do it.
Oh, well, I don't know all those directions you gave. Seemed a little crazy. Somehow I figured it out, though. So
yes.
If I did, everybody else can, I'm sure.
And if you have problems accessing your paid-for extended content,
yeah,
then you can get in touch with me, not with John.
Yeah, don't call me. I don't know anything.
And I can contact you personally, and we can work this out.
There we go.
So, patreon.com/earthoddity.
Extend your oddity.
That's right. Speaking of extensions, speaking of the extended show, you got anything you'd like to tease in the extended show? What you got coming up?
I got a story about a mother and son love problems.
Okay.
All right.
Local story.
Yeah. Yeah.
I've got a story about a government official in the Philippines who may have been acting a certain way in a Zoom meeting.
Okay.
That may or may not have gotten him fired.
Oh, wow. Okay. All right. That's a tough one.
Well, other than that, you got anything else?
Nope. Just thank all of our listeners, every one of you. You're all important. We love all of you. And just tell a friend about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just remember, I know the world's a little weird right now. A lot of stuff's going on. Whatever side of the spectrum you fall on politically, just remember to love one another.
Yes.
That's the only way we're going to be able to get through any of this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Just everybody be cool. Right?
Yes, absolutely. We are... we can disagree, but ultimately we are all fellow human beings.
That's right.
And remember the words of Jesus when he said we need to love our neighbors as ourselves.
That's right.
If everybody would just do that.
Whoa, sorry. That was wrong. That was wrong. This is why I'm going to get kicked out of church one day. You know?
Yes.
Yeah.
You have been listening to Earth Oddity Podcast, and we thank you so much for listening to us, no matter where you get us, whether you get us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, iHeartRadio, CastBox.
We're on them all.
We're on them all. If you would like to email into the show, we are earthoddity@planetmail.net. If you would like to tweet at us, we are @_EarthOddity on Twitter.
That's right.
We have an amazing guy running our Instagram account.
Right. Shout out to Nicole again. Yes.
You can check out that show art @_EarthOddity on Instagram. But the best way to get in touch with us, especially if you're Nicole or
Nate,
then we have a phone number. What's that handy dandy phone number?
It's 662-493-2059. That's 662-493-2059.
We hope everyone out there has an excellent week. Earth Oddity for the Fringe Radio Network signing off.
Love y'all.
Bye.
This has been a very odd production. Thanks for listening.